In this class, we'll begin with a small signal. It's supposed to be single stage. Yeah, so we'll just begin with the single stage amplifiers. And the type of amplifiers that we are going to discuss under this category is, the first one is the CS amplifier or the common source amplifier. The second one would be the common drain. The third one is the common gate, okay? So these are the three different type of amplifiers, we'll be looking at it. And now what I do is that before we jump into the CS amplifier and further step down to further categories of it, I just want to talk about the device parameters when we look from the perspective of an analog designer, okay? From the perspective of analog designer, there are some set of parameters that we are being concerned. The first parameter that we are concerned is about the GM, okay? Now, why this GM is so important is that this actually defines the speed, and also any guess why we are concerned about the GM? Gain, yeah, obviously the voltage gain, because we know that any voltage gain expression could be expressed as GM times R out, right? So this is one of the parameter. The second one is the capacitance. So again, we have to deal with the CGS and CGD. So again, this capacitance would then impact our speed of the circuit. So whenever I say about the speed, what I'm really talking is about the bandwidth of the circuit, okay? So currently we will not deal with this, but later on as we move on, we'll just talk about how this CGS or CGD is going to impact our circuit performance. And the third one is the output impedance. Now again, this output impedance would then impact your speed as well, okay? So you still have the speed being concerned. And apart from this, what else it impacts, the output impedance? Power, or as I said before, what about the voltage gain? The voltage gain also has one more parameter, right? So it is capital GM times R out. So it also impacts our voltage gain, okay? So, and there is, again, one more thing is the current that has been drawn through ID, okay? So is there any specific reason why I'm concerned with the DC current? Power, yeah, of course. So one of the major reasons that we are concerned is about the power dissipation in a circuit. Okay, and we also be concerned about the maximum voltage swings, okay? So the maximum output voltage swing, okay? So we'll be concerned about these things. So now that when I look into the parameters that I was expressing here, you could be able to note that the first three parameters are with respect to a small signal. Am I right? Whereas about the last two is basically with respect to the large signal. For the amplifiers that we are going to discuss in the coming session, I will not be concerned about this capacitance. I will leave out this for a while. And later when we talk about the frequency response, I'll just get back to this, but we'll hold this, we'll pause this particular analysis for a while, okay? The capacitance. But otherwise, I'll be concerned with the GM, I'll be concerned with the output impedance in order to compute the gain. And I'll also be concerned about this. And again, what I do is that I will leave out this ID, power dissipation, but what I take into account is the maximum output swing that I'm getting out of the circuit. So as of now, I'm just neglecting this and this particular parameter for the coming analysis. Any doubt in this? So an analog designer, in general, look across these parameters. And among this, I'll be picking only two from the small signal parameters and one from the large signal parameters. Whenever I say about the CS amplifier, the input always somehow connects to our gate, okay? So the input is actually connected to the gate and the output is somehow taken out from the which terminal? From the drain terminal, right? Let me draw a simple CS amplifier. So I'll just begin with an NMOS transistor. Okay. Now here is my Vout and here is my Vin. So I'm just mixing up the notations. Yeah. So now, as I said, one could broadly classify the CS amplifier into two categories. Okay. One of the classification would be having a particular load across the drain and then tap the output over here. Okay. Whereas the other end of my terminal is going to get connected to my ground. So this kind of amplifier is just a simple CS amplifier. Okay, so now according to this load, I can have different type of loads here. Okay, so we will be talking about four different type of loads. One is having this with a resistive load. The second one is replacing this guy with something known as diode connected. And the third one is to replace this with a current source load. And the fourth one is to have a triode connected load. Okay, so we will not concentrate much on this, but I will just give the formula for the voltage gain for it. Okay, so is that is clear? So one could classify this as one of the structure for a CS amplifier, but there is also one more similar structure that we can have. What is that? Yeah, with source degeneration. So again, I will have the same similar structure at the top. The only change that I have between this type of circuit and the source degeneration is to add a resistance to the source terminal. Okay, so adding this would then create a structure which is called as a CS amplifier with source degeneration. Okay. So this is the second category. The first category doesn't have this RS, whereas in the second category, we have this CS amplifier with source degeneration. Okay, hope that it is clear. Now, what is actually happening in this CS amplifier is that you could be able to see that there is a change in this Vin, and this change in this Vin is actually captured by the current, that is small ID. And this current ID, when it is flowing through this load, it is getting converted in terms of voltage. Is that is clear? It is actually happening from small signal Vin, it translates into small signal ID, and this ID, when it flows through the load, it gets translated as Vout. Okay, so that is the actual mechanism that we have across this amplifier. The first one. Now, in this case, you have already seen what would be the gain of this particular circuit. Yeah, in this case, I'm just going to assume that the lambda is not equal to zero. But if that is the case, what would be the expression for this? But not many people are answering it. Okay, so it would be minus GM. Say, for example, if it is M1, then I can just write it as GM1 times that of the upward output impedance is nothing but RD. Okay, when I look down through the drain, I will be looking at the what is the value of it? R0, okay? So those are the output impedance. So I have RD in parallel with R0, okay? So RO1. Is that is clear? So this first term is nothing but the transconductance of my circuit. This is the capital GM. And the second term is nothing but the Rout of my circuit. It's just the product of both. Okay? So now having this as my circuit, what we do is that we'll just talk about the output swing, okay? So now whenever I talk about this output swing, I'm always concerned with something known as the output maximum minus the output minimum that I can have, such that whatever the transistors that I have. So in this case, we have only one single transistor. So that transistor has to stay inside the saturation regime. Okay. So the transistor or transistors has to be in saturation regime. You have to ensure that. Clear? So now, in that case, so how would I define my VO max for this particular design, and how will I mark this VO minimum? Because we have the gain to be minus GM. So this minus actually indicates that there is an inversion. Okay, it's an inverting amplifier. But apart from this, but what I really wanted is, how far, say for example, this is my Q point, okay? This is my input Q point, and let me just have the same similar structure here. And I have a DC, right? So this DC, let me take it as VGSQ, and over this DC, I'm just going to have a small wiggle with a small VGS, okay? And similarly, I will have RD, and over here, you could actually decompose into two components, but I'll just write it as V out. Okay, so now what is happening is that over here, this is my fixed Q point, and over this Q point, I'm trying to have a small wiggle. This small wiggle is actually creating an output, okay, across, which is swinging across my, what is this particular quantity? The Q point at the output, okay, or VDSQ or VOUTQ, because in this case, whatever the voltage that I have across this drain to source is actually nothing but my VOUT, right? So I could write the Q point as something like VOUTQ. So over this VOUTQ, I'm just going to have this wiggle, but this wiggle is going to be large, am I right? Just because there is a gain from here to here, right? So the whole point is that how far this can go up and how far this can go down, such that none of my transistors in the circuits are going away from the saturation, okay? And that is what we are going to deal. So in this, the very first thing is I have to be clear that the Q point has to be somewhere middle, only then I can just talk, right? So we'll assume that whenever we try to talk about this output swing, we assume that it is somewhere in the middle, so that I have symmetrical swing across the input and output, okay, or between the negative and the positive swings. Clear? Yeah. So how far this guy can go up so that my transistor stays in the saturation regime?
VDD minus ADR should be greater than
or equal to. Okay. As you said, I have this Vout expression that could be written as VDD minus IDRD. So this is my Q point, okay, or I can also write it as something like Vout equals to VDD minus IDRD. Yeah. So now the whole point is that how would we identify this quantity, how far it can reach, so that I'm still in the saturation regime? No. What is this voltage that I have? It is equal to VDD, right? So even if this guy all the way reaches here, what is happening is that I can just all the way reach, because throughout this entire regime, I'm still in the saturation region. It can go up. So it can all the way barely touches my VDD. Still, I'll be in the saturation regime. Are you clear with this? Is there any doubt with this? The only thing is that appropriately I have to make my input to swing. So when the input reaches a value of VT, okay, what is happening is that the current becomes equal to zero, due to which we have an output max which is equal to VDD, right? So there is a swing, and this swing is actually can go all the way till VDD, and that is what I'm trying to explain here. Are you clear with this? Just by looking at this output characteristic graph, we could actually map this. And how did we get this particular graph? We just went on with a plot of ID versus VDS graph, and then on this graph what we did is that we just try to fix our load line, right? So we just plotted a load line, and from the load line one could plot this Vout versus Vin just by eliminating the ID expression out of it. This is how we got it. Is there any doubt in this? Are you clear with this? You want me to tell again like how this particular plot is being plotted? You want it? Okay. But in the next week we'll be having a quiz, so I have to cover up the lot of portions. So I'll just plot it roughly, okay? So let me plot it for VGS 1, VGS 2, VGS 3, and VGS 4, okay? Yeah, and I also have this Vout that could be expressed as VDD minus ID times RD, okay? Now, this Vout is also equal to our VDS for the structure that I have. Okay, so this is a structure that we have. And now what happens the moment the value of Vn is less than Vt? Yeah, it would be in cutoff. And we know that in the cutoff, the current drawn by the transistor would be equal to zero. So the ID is actually equal to zero. And what happens is that when I plug in over here, this would define that the VDS or the Vout supposed to be equal to VDD, and you would be marking this axis because this is the one that marks our VDS, right? And over here, if I pick this as my VDD point, then this is the point at which it intersects, okay? So now what happens is that I try to increase the value of Vin above the value of VT, so due to which there will be a small amount of current that draws, okay? So it's almost closer to the value of zero, but still a fraction of current flows through the device, and due to which, what happens to this entire expression? Yeah, this will start rising badly just because the value of Vin has got a bit more than the value of Vt, due to which the current is also small, and it is trying to reduce the value of Vout from the value of VDD, right? So it drops. So due to which, say for example, for the given value of VGS, I have a current, and this is the current that I have, and due to which I have a corresponding VDS value, and both these would then intersect here, right? So again, when you go for a different value of VGS2, you will have a particular amount of current that's flowing through the device, and that current, when I plug in here, the value of VDS or the Vout will further drop, okay? And due to which, an intersection point would appear. So this is how we drawn, right? So we went from something like this, and as you could see that I started from the cutoff, and then I got into my saturation regime, because this is the region where I'm in the saturation, and then as I keep increasing the value of my Vin, you could able to see that I'm just touching this edge of saturation, and anything beyond the value of VGS4, so VGS3, okay, so all my writings has gone. Okay, anyhow, I'll just try to quickly mark those points. So this would be my load line. Okay, so what are the value of VGS? If I'm going beyond this VGS3, what happens is that my transistor gets into linear regime or the triode regime. Okay. Yeah. So now in this case, you could able to see that if I want to stay inside the saturation regime, I have to be within these boundaries. The output swing has to be within this boundary so that I still stay in the saturation regime. Is that as clear? So if I fix my Q point somewhere here, then if I have a swing around this VGS, then the VGS would then create a change in the current, and that is how it gets translated. So from this graph, we actually went on to plot something known as Vin versus Vout. Okay, so in this case, what I did is that I just translated this VDS as Vout, and whatever the points that I'm picking from here has to be plotted here, okay? And these are the points which are nothing but getting translated into the value of Vin, right? VGS is nothing but the value of Vins. So when I had my Vin that is less than Vt, there is no current, and due to which I had an output which was equal to VDD. So from zero till the value of Vth, what is happening is that there is zero current, and due to which I stay in the same regime whose value of Vout is basically equal to VDD. But once I cross this particular regime, what is happening is that the output is keep shifting towards the lower and lower values, right? And due to which the graph would then be plotted something like this. But the moment I reach here, the graph will not fall at the same rate, but rather it tends to slow down this particular rate. So why is the slowdown that happens over once I get into the linear regime? Linear dependency is not purely because of that. Basically because there is a bunch of lines that are spaced much closer here. Whereas when you look here, these current lines are being spaced much far apart. Okay, so you have a much linear regime. But as you increase the value of VGS, further and further, the bunch of lines actually hits much closer, okay, in the linear regime, and due to which the transition to a lower value is becoming shorter and shorter. Okay, we discussed all these things. You please go through the video again, because I cannot teach it again, and it will take a hell lot of time for us to revisit everything. Okay, yeah. So we also spotted that there is a particular point, and this particular point is what we called as VOV. Okay, so right from this spot to this spot, the transistor was staying in the saturation regime. That is, right from this point till this point, the entire regime, I was staying in the saturation region. Okay, now whenever I was in saturation region, what is the Vout value that I'm having here? What is the maximum that I'm having? VDD. What is the minimum that I'm having here? How do I read this value? Edge of saturation, right? So when VDS is equal to VGS minus VT or VGS3. So according to this graph, it is VGS3 minus VT, okay, which is generally called as VOV. Okay, so clearly I can have a VO max all the way till VDD, but the lower swing can all the way can have a minimum swing of VOV. Okay, I'll just put a suffix of 1 just because it is the VOE that I'm referring to the transistor M1. Clear? So those are the minimum and the maximum swings that I can have across a Q point. Okay, so if the Q point is in the middle, it is fine enough. Your outputs would swing around these points. So whenever there is a swing, I still stay in the saturation regime. Clear? Ensure that you are in the saturation regime. Clear? Any doubt in this? Okay. So now that we discussed about all those characteristics of this CS amplifier with a resistive load, but we also have to look across its drawbacks. Okay. So one of the major drawbacks that one could find is about the GM itself. In order to really see what is this drawback is all about, we will just try to write the expression of this GM. Okay. Now, there is a particular form of GM which everyone knows is nothing but it is proportional to Kn dash W by L and then VGS minus VT or VOV. Now what happens when I try to plot this graph where I am trying to plot this GM versus the Vin? So what is this Vin? How is this Vin is related to my VGS? It's a CS amplifier with a resistive load, nothing else. Both are equal, right? Yeah, so my VGS is actually equal to my Vin. Now what happens the moment I try to plot these two guys? Okay, so till I reach this value of VT, what would be the value of GM? Zero, okay? So you will not have any kind of graph. But what happens after this? Decrease, increase. So they will increase at a constant rate, okay? Now, there is a particular point, according to the graph that I plotted before, this is nothing but my VGS3, okay? This Vin1 is nothing but the plot that I showed earlier is this intersection point, okay? This particular point, clear? Yeah, so till this particular point, I just try to plot this graph as a kind of very straight line because they are proportional to each other, no change in my GM, okay? Now, what happens the moment I cross this VGS3? In this case, my transistor M1 was in saturation, right? So here I was in saturation, but below this value of VT, which region my M1 was in? It was in cutoff, okay? But above this regime, which region I'm entering? I'm entering into the linear regime. Now, how will I plot this GM? Will it stay as it is, or will it go up, or will it go down? Constant. Do you all feel the same? Okay, what is the value of GM in the case of a linear regime? So you... No, like we'll go with the same definition of this GM is always equal to a partial derivative of ID with respect to VGS, always, okay? Whatever regime it is. So in this case, we know that the current in the linear regime could be expressed as Kn dash W by L and then VGS minus VT and then we have VDS and VDS square by 2, okay? And this is the current that I have in the linear regime, right? So what if I try to differentiate this quantity? Yeah, so I'll just come up with the answer that I have something like Kn dash W by L and then this quantity would then goes for a value of 1 and due to which I have something related to VDS. Now you might expect that the graph is supposed to be a constant, but it's a CS amplifier. What happens to my value of VDS if I go beyond this particular line or if I try to increase the value of VGS upward? What is happening to my VDS? Is it staying in the same level? Am I fixed to the same value? No. You see, the intersection point goes towards the left further. So there is still change in the value of VDS as I increase the value of Vin. Are you clear with this? Okay. So due to which, how does this plot supposed to look? is the value of VDS is increasing or reducing? That you tell. It is reducing. So as I increase the value of Vin, this guy is reducing. Right. So I cannot have something like an increasing graph. The way that I can draw is by having some sort of nonlinear graph, just because of the closeness of the lines of IDs that I have. Okay. Over here, these IDs are so closer. So even for a larger value of increase, the VDS spots are getting closer and closer. Okay. The VDS spots are getting closer and closer before it reaches to a value of, it is not actually zero, but getting closer to the value of zero. Okay. So due to which, the rate at which it changes goes something like this. Okay. Yeah. Now, anyhow, I'm not concerned with this linear region, nor I'm not concerned with this guy with the cutoff region. But what I'm concerned is about the linear region, the region at which I'm going to operate my device. Okay. Now, what is the problem having this kind of GM? Yeah, why is that? We need a constant GM. You are closer to the answer. Yeah, this is constant. But why I need a constant GM? Yes, exactly. You see, the gain is always expressed as minus GM. I'll just drop out this lambda. Okay, so I'll just have just GM times RD. I'm not taking into account R naught. Okay, for the discussion. Now the point is that you see, whenever there is a change in your VGSQ, say for example, due to some sort of problem, I have changed my battery or my battery is getting leaked out. So due to which, what happens is that the GM, the VGSQ that I fixed, will change over a time. Okay, either it goes upward or downward, doesn't matter. But the point is that whatever the VGSQ that I'm fixing, I have to end up having the same gain. But what would happen in this case? Are you clear with this discussion? What I'm trying to say is that I've just built a kind of an IC, and in that IC, I'm just fixing a kind of battery. Okay. Now, over a period of time, the battery will not stay constant, right? So it will change or it decays, and due to which the voltage that I put across this particular CS amplifier will also get varied. Okay. So this is no more a constant voltage. This voltage would then slightly lowers, and due to which, what is happening is that instead of getting a value of GM of this, I'm getting a lower value of GM. Once this is happening, what happens is that the gain obviously drops down over a time, which we don't want in our circuit. Okay, so this is one of the major problems. I don't want this to happen. So how I can rectify this issue? The issue is having a GM that is proportional to something related to my VGSQ. If I could able to somehow break this kind of relation, then somewhere I could do something. Or the other way around is that I don't want this gain to be dependent on my Q values. Okay. So this is the gain. I don't want to depend on the Q. Okay. I don't want this dependency of gain on the Q points. Okay. So did you get this? Any doubt in this regard? I will take this as my first drawback. The second drawback that we'll talk, say for example, I just want to increase the gain of this particular CS amplifier. Okay. Now, what are the ways by which we can do it? I've already given some sort of hint. Yeah, so there are two ways, as you said, because we know that the gain is a product of GM times RD. So if I want to increase this gain, I either have to increase the GM, or I have to increase this RD, or you can increase both. But we have to see what are the other impacts that we are going to get when I try to do so. So first we'll begin with this option of increasing the value of GM. Okay. Now, what are the different ways by which I can increase this GM? Obviously, because we know that GM is actually equal to Kn dash W by L and then VOV. Okay. So in order to increase this guy, I can go with the increase in the value of W. Okay, so that is the first option that I would take. So when I try to increase this width, what could possibly can happen is that the current, will it stay constant throughout the circuit? That will also increase. Now, having increase in this current, what would it do for us? Yeah, one is the power dissipation. Yeah. Apart from this, how is my Vout Q point is defined? Vout Q. Yeah, it is VDD minus IDRD. So in a graph something like this, where I just want to plot Vout versus Vin, we know that we want this Q point to stay between this regime somewhere in the middle, right? So we want it somewhere here. But what happens the moment I try to increase the value of width in order to increase the gain of this particular circuit? We are trying to in turn increase the value of ID. And when I try to increase this guy, what happens to the Q point? The Q point is approaching closer and closer to this linear regime. Okay? So in a way, yeah, obviously, because we want a higher gain, and when I try to do so, the Q point is getting shifted here. And now that when I try to apply my swing around this, it is not symmetrically getting amplified. Till this particular regime, I'd be amplified, but after then, the part of the signal is not amplified properly, just because the slope of this linear regime is completely different from the slope of what I have in my saturation regime. Okay, that is the problem that I'm facing. The Q point is getting shifted. One is the power dissipation, okay, and the second point is that the Q point is getting shifted. Yeah. So what else we have in order to increase this GM? Is there any other way by which? So one of the quantity that we have in our control is this W that we did it. What else we have in our control? VOE, which is nothing but VGS minus VT. So in a way that I just want to work with my Vin, that is the capital Vin Q, that is a Q point. So I try to increase this guy. What happens after, once I do that? When I try to increase this V in Q in order to have the GM, because whatever the expression that I've written down, VOE, is nothing but depends on the Q point of my input, okay, capital VGS. Now, when I increase the value of VGSQ, what happens to my circuit?
Current increases.
Yeah, current increases. We end up with the same problem, right? Same thing is happening. Either you go with the width, or either you go with the VGSQ, we result in the same issue of power dissipation and thus shifting in the Q point. So that is not helping us. So what we do is that we'll just go for the second option, where I try only to increase the RD value. Okay?
Huh? Increase RD again, Q point is again.
Yes. The problem with this method is that, again, when I look back into my expression, what is happening to my Vout Q? When I try to increase this guy, the Vout Q is further getting shifted. Okay, so again the problem is that the Q point is getting shifted. So there is a third option, which I think you might go with it, just because I'm just trying to increase the value of RD, but in a way I'm trying to increase reduce the value of ID, such that I'm trying to address this issue that I had before. Are you getting? So this time I'm not only increasing the RD, but parallelly I'm trying to reduce the value of ID, such that the Q point is not getting shifted. But does this method works, or does it have any other issues with it? Can it work fruitfully for us?
So in order to decrease ID, we have to decrease the width.
Yeah, come. Of course. Okay, doing one thing, trying to fix this, is actually making our ID to reduce. In a way, we are trying to reduce the value of GM. Okay, so in a way, the product of these two terms are ending up having somewhere constant. We are not doing anything. We couldn't be able to increase. Okay, so there are too many issues with this particular circuit setup. Okay, one was our change in the value of GM over VGSQ. Okay, the second one, that if at all if you want to increase anything, we have to lose something else. Okay, so the Q point is keep getting shifted, okay, or the GM is getting shifted. So these are getting interlooped, and we could able to see that clearly there exists a trade-off between the gain and the bandwidth. Anyhow, it might not be clear, but I will talk about it, and about the voltage swing. So there exists a kind of trade-off between all the three different parameters. But how does this bandwidth is getting trade-off here? Okay, in very short, I will just write it as omega is nothing but the angular frequency, which one could write in terms of R and C. So how will I express this omega as? No, just R and C. We'll not talk about 1 by? Yeah. Okay. So, in this case, the R is nothing but our output impedance. But the C is again could be some sort of capacity load that I have. Okay. So say for example, in these cases, when I try to work with the value of RD, I'm trying to increase the value of resistance. So in a way, that the resistance when it tries to shoot up, what is happening to the bandwidth of the circuit? It reduces, okay? So if you're not clear with this concept, don't worry, okay? When we discuss about the frequency response, we'll talk about this. But as of now, it is in turn getting impacting my circuit's bandwidth, okay? So even when you try to increase the width, the input capacitance will also rise up. Why is that? I'm trying to increase the width of my transistor, due to which, what happens to the input capacitance of my transistor M1? Increases. Why does this CG increases? Yeah. So the input capacitance, if at all, if I define it as CGS, it is nothing but it's a product of oxide capacitance per unit area multiplied by the length into the width. Right. So when I increase this guy, proportionally the CGS also increases. And in a way, it affects my bandwidth as well. Okay. So whatever we do, all of these three parameters are getting linked up. Okay. So it is something like, okay, so since I'm married, I can just tell this particular joke. Okay. So it is something like hanging a person hanging between a wife and a mother. Okay. So you neither cannot go this side, nor you cannot go that side. Okay. So it is something like that. Clear? Okay. So now we'll just come to an important part. We'll just move on to the next one, where we will talk about CS amplifier with diode connected. So now that we'll just replace this load, because having this load had created a lot of issues. Okay, having a residue load has a lot of issues. Apart from this, the one thing that I didn't talk about it is having a residue load has some other issue. What about the area that it occupies? It occupies a hell lot of area when you put it in a chip. Okay, so again, the area matters when we go for a residue load. So in order to combat all these issues, we are going for a load which has been built by making use of some sort of transistor. Okay, so one of the first type of load that we are going to discuss over here is a diode connected load. Okay, so I just want to summarize this diode connected configuration's resistance. Okay, so I'll just quickly draw some of the structures thing. So what will be the impedance of this? Okay, so it is 1 by GM parallel R naught. Okay, okay, so let me just have, what about this? I'm looking into source. Yeah, so what is the difference between these two impedances? Are they same? No, what is the difference? Is it diode connected first of all? Yes, because the gate and the drains were at the same potentials, right? So it is still a diode connected. But what is the difference in formula that I would have when I'm looking at this same NMOS, looking at this particular point, looking at the same NMOS structure, but from the source I'm looking at it? Yeah, so there is a body effect, right? Okay, whereas in this case, we don't have any body effect, okay? I guess it is not an NMOS, I'm talking about the PMOS, okay? Yeah. So it would be like 1 by GM in parallel with GMB in parallel with R0. Or in short, one could write something like GM plus GMB in parallel with R0. Or again, it's my notation of writing the summation of GM plus GMB as GM prime times R0. Okay. Having this as my load, let us try to use it in our CS amplifier and then try to figure out. Okay, I will not go with this PMOS, but rather I will just go with an NMOS. Now, I want you people to derive the gain of this particular circuit, assuming that the bottom transistor is M1 and the top transistor is M2. Yeah, what is the transconductance of this device? Which GM? GM1 itself. Okay, so you see, one could actually mimic this entire M2 transistor as a kind of resistance, right? There is no harm in looking this as a resistor because it acts as a load. Okay. Now, it is almost identical to what I had before, right? So in that case, what was my GM? It was just GM1, minus GM1 to be frank, okay? So the capital GM of the circuit will still remain the same because when I short this particular node to the ground, no current would flow through this R. So I'm nowhere concerned with this R, okay? Yeah. So what about this R out? So that I can just use those two terms. Okay, so when I look up, yeah, so it would be 1 by GM dash parallel with R naught. Okay, so when I look down, R naught 1, so this is supposed to be 2 then, okay, and RO 2. Okay, so what I have at the top is nothing but 1 by GM 2 prime parallel with RO2, and then this RO1 also falls in parallel with whatever I had it at the top, right? So due to which I just write it as RO1. Is that is all clear? So how will I compute the gain from this? Just multiply both this quantity, you get the gain, right? So I'll just take up the space. I don't know what I have in the next page. Okay, I'll use this. Now, for our analysis purpose, what we do is that we'll perform some sort of simplification such that it gives some sort of insight into the formulae. Okay? So what I'm going to do is that I'm just going to assume that the lambda is equal to 0 for both the devices. Okay, lambda 1, come on, lambda 2 is actually equal to 0. So obviously, this formula would then be reduced down to just GM1 by GM2 prime. So again, one could write this in terms of GM itself, right? So I have something like GM1 by GM2 into 1 plus eta. So how did I write this formula? How do I express this GMB in terms of GM? It is nothing but eta times that of GM. Okay, so I use this formula to replace this summation, or replace this GMB with eta times that of GM. Okay. Again, to have some sort of insight, I'm just going to assume one more thing. We don't have body effect. Now, how will I express this GM1 by GM2 ratio? The ratio of these two terms. What is this GM1? You have something like Kn dash W by L. You express that. So let us try to express that. I try to replace this with something like minus as a common. But at the top, what I have is Kn dash W by L of 1 and then VOV 1, right? So at the bottom, what I have is GM2, the top transistor, which I can write it as Kn dash W by L of 2 and then VOV 2. Clear? So obviously, you could be able to find that the Kn dash parameters could be cancelled, okay? Just because they are same, I can just cancel it. And what about this W by L factors? We'll further do some simplification. You see, we are simplifying so much in order to get to a small essence of it, okay? So I'll just assume that both my W by L factors of 1 and 2 are equal. So again, I can cancel them. First of all, is the way that I did, is it correct? Can I use this form of GM to express the gain? Yeah, I guess it is in saturation just because I assume that the transistors are in saturation. But there is a flaw in this particular formula that I substituted. We are simplifying. We assume we are in an ideal world. But still, this formula has some sort of drawback because this was a question that has been asked even in the textbook. Yeah, VOV? Okay, so whenever we try to substitute some sort of formula as a ratios, they generally have to have some sort of commonality between them. Okay, so I'm not talking about the commonality of this Kn dash or W by L, but something has to be common between both the transistors, or something has to connect both the transistors parameters. Okay, so if I go back and look into my circuit, you could see if I try to plot a current, The current is the one that flows between this M2 and M1. Apart from that, no other terms like VOV or any other terms are related to each other, or they are being connected with each other. Is the whole point is clear? Can you be able to link? The point is that I have to link this M1 and M2 whenever I find some sort of ratio in my expression. Okay, the one quantity that connects both the transistor M1 and M2 is just the current, ID current that flows. Okay, VOE is nowhere connected to my M1 and M2, right? The VOE of this transistor, is it connected to this?
No,
it is not connected actually. Okay, the only component that I have among this entire thing is the ID, because the ID, whatever the ID that flows in M2 has to be the same even across my M1. That is the one particular parameter that is common to both. If that is the case, can I go and use this formula? Because in this particular formula, I don't find any ID term. There is no quantity that is common to both. In that case, I cannot use this formula. But what are the other type of formulas that I have for the GM? Yeah, so we also have something like GM, that is nothing but 2ID by VOV. Can I use this formula? Obviously, because there is an ID that is common to both, due to which I try to substitute. Okay, so in short, this is not correct. And I just write the gain expression of AV again, but in terms of this quantity. So I just substitute as 2ID by VOV 1 divided by 2ID by VOV of 2. Now that I can just perform this cancellation, just because the IDs are same. And the moment I do this, you see that the VOV 2 is coming at the top, while VOV 1 is coming as a denominator. Whereas in the top formula that I used, my VOV 1 was at the top, my VOV 2 was at the bottom. Okay? In the textbook, they had done both, and they had asked how both the quantities are possible. Okay? They haven't given the answer, but the answer is that whenever you substitute, you ensure that one particular parameter is common to both. In this case, the ID is the one that stays common to both the transistors, so I have to use this kind of formula. Okay? So you cannot use this expression in order to substitute over there. Did you all got cleared? Yeah. Now we also have one more form of GM, right? What is that form? Yeah, so I have something like square root of 2 ID KN dash W by L. So when I try to substitute, what would be the expression that I would get? By looking at it, ID is common, I can cancel it. KN dash is also common, I can cancel it. Yes. It is a ratio of W by L of 1 divided by W by L of 2. Okay? Now, what was the problem with the CS amplifier with the residual load? The gain was dependent on somewhere to the Q point. Now, in this case, had we really took off that particular drawback in the circuit? Look at this formula. It depends purely on my W by L factors. I've actually removed it. Even if you use this, it has some sort of issues, but the point is that I still have one more quantity that is common. Okay, so I can work with this to increase the gain. No issues would come. Okay, so I'll talk about, again, there is some set of drawbacks, and we'll try to address those drawbacks in the next class, and we'll continue from diode connected to what is known as current source load. Okay. Is that is all clear? Yeah, so the expression number 1 and 2 are correct, but this expression is not correct. Okay, I can use this as well as the other one at the bottom. The only thing is that somehow I have a ratio here. The ratio of Q points are there, due to which we can actually work with it. Clear? So, whereas in the previous case, the gain was not as a ratio of Q points. It was actually proportional to my Q point. Okay? Whereas in this case, I have a ratio of Q point, so we can actually manipulate it properly. Okay? So we have addressed one of the issue, but when I try to address one of the issue, obviously, as I said, we will have some sort of other issues. Okay? So we'll talk about those issues in the next class.